Hello everyone, in this session we are going to learn the lesson in geography. Resources and development. These are the topics we are going to cover today. Now we'll move on to the lesson. What is a resource? I'm going to break the definition into two parts. Everything in our environment that can be used to satisfy our need is generally what we call it as a resource. For example, the land, soil is all an example of resource. The second part of the definition, if you see, resource must be technologically accessible, economically feasible, culturally acceptable. One by one, we'll understand the terms given here. So first, technologically accessible. The government or any private institution who enrich the resources must have appropriate technology. So that is what technologically accessible. The next one is economically feasible. So if an area is identified to have resources, then we must have appropriate technology to do the mining activity, as well as the investment is made to obtain the resources. So if the investment made is high and the outcome what we obtain is less, then it is not economically feasible. So always the outcome must be profitable. And third one is the culturally acceptable. When we obtain the resource, it should not disturb the cultural values of people living in that particular area. For example, most of the resources are located in the forest area. So what happens when we enrich the resource in the forest area, the tribal people and the Adivasi communities are evacuated from that particular area. But if they are provided with better livelihood opportunities and if they are convinced the resource is for nation's good, then the resource which we obtain is accepted as a profitable resource. Okay, so this is the definition for resources. We are going to see is types of resources. There are three types of resources: natural, human made and human resources. So natural resources, anything that is readily available in our environment for our consumption, we call that as a natural resource. Example, forest. Then human made resources. The natural resources, when it is all converted into more usable form, we call that as a human made resources. Like how the land is a natural resource and it is converted as a buildings, apartments, where the people could readily get access into it. So that is what we call it as a human made resources. And the last type of resources, human resources. The potential of the individual or the community to convert all the available resources into a more useful one, then it is what we call it as a human. With the human's intervention only, we convert all the resources that is available into a better one. So human itself is considered as a important resource. The next topic is classification of natural resources. So the classification is on the basis of origin, on the basis of exhaustibility, on the basis of ownership, on the basis of development. So the first is on the basis of origin. The resources can be classified into biotic and abiotic resources. Biotic resources means any resources which we obtain from the biosphere, like all the living things falls into the biotic resources. On the other hand, if you see abiotic resources, anything composed of non-living things, we call that as a abiotic resources. Example, soil, rocks and all part of abiotic resources. The next classification is on the basis of exhaustibility. It is further classified into renewable and non-renewable resources. Renewable resources are the one which can be renewed or reproduced, like solar energy, wind energy, which we obtain from the nature. On the other side, non-renewable energy resources are the one which is going to take a long time period for the formation. Once we use the resource and if it gets exhausted, it is not going to be recreated. It takes a long geological time period for the formation. That is what we call it as a non-renewable resources. Example, fossil fuels. Here you can see the difference between renewable and non-renewable energy resources. So, renewable resource, it can be renewed in a short period of time, whereas non-renewable resources cannot be renewed. And second point, if you see, the renewable resources like the solar energy, wind energy and all is not going to harm the environment, whereas non-renewable resources is going to cause pollution. The third one, if you see, the renewable resources are considered to be free gifts of the nature, whereas non-renewable, as we know, it is going to take a long period of time for the formation. It is not considered as a free gifts of nature. And the example, renewable, it is air, water and solar energy, whereas for the non-renewable, it is mineral, oil and coal. The next classification is on the basis of ownership: individual, community, national and international resources. Individual resource, the resource which are owned privately by the individual. The individual will have complete control over the resources present here, like the house, land. So any decision regarding it, it will be taken by the individual. They are not dependent on any other person. Next one is the community resource, where the members of a community have complete access to the resources, like the public parks, playgrounds, picnic spots. We all have access to these resources. The next one is the national resource. The resources belongs to the government. So the government have legal power to acquire the resources present in the nation. For example, if a government wants a land for the expansion of railway network or the roadways, the government can access it. They can take it from the individual for the betterment of the nation. The next one is the international resource. These are international institutions which regulate some resources. For example, the ocean. So till 200 nautical miles, it becomes a territorial water. Beyond the 200 nautical miles, the water falls into an international category. So it is international waters where the United Nations is the authorized authority to take decision regarding the international waters. The next classification is on the basis of status of development. Potential resources, the resource which is found in a abundance but have not been developed properly, like the solar energy and wind energy in Gujarat and Rajasthan region. See, the availability of solar energy is huge, right, in these areas, but how much we develop it, how much we consume it is very, very less than the potential, right? So that is potential resources. The next one is the developed resources, where the exact quantity and quality, so where the resources available and how well we can use it, and with the appropriate technology, when we plan all these things, we call that as a developed resources. The next one is the stock, the resources which have potential to satisfy our need, but the technology to use it is not developed yet, so that we call it as a stock. Then next one is the reserve. The technology is available, but the exploration of the resources not yet started, right? So those are for the future purpose. So that is what we call it as a reserved resources. The next topic is development of resources. Resources are considered to be free gifts of nature. So what do? We use the resource indiscriminately, and overuse of resources at many places. So what happened? All these led to major problems. Some three major problems are listed here. The first one is a depletion of resources. The resources are depleting in nature, right? So most of the resources what we use is of non-renewable nature. So when we continuously use it, at a point of time, it becomes exhausted. So depletion of resources. Then second one is the accumulation of resources. If you see, the resources are not equally distributed throughout the nation. So what happens? The resource-rich land becomes rich and the other area becomes poor. So accumulation of resources in few hands leads to a problem. And the next one is the exploitation. So the exploitation of resources leads to ecological crisis. So global ecological crisis is a major problem here. Global warming, ozone layer depletion, environmental pollution, land degradation, all this because of indiscriminate use of the resources. But the main thing is, development should happen, whereas the resources also to be conserved. For this purpose, we have come up with a concept called the concept of sustainable development. It means development should take place without damaging the environment, and development in the present should not compromise with the needs of the future generation. So the development should happen at the same time. We should see to that the resources available for the future generations. So to emphasize on this concept, the world leaders came together, and that is what we call it as an International Earth Summit, which happened in the year 1992 at the place called Rio de Janeiro. Right. So the summit, what it addressed is most important problem, how to protect the environment, at the same time how to focus on the developmental activities. So the global leader agreed to the conventions over there, and it was put together as Agenda 21, and it was signed by the world leaders. The main aim of this Agenda 21 is to obtain global sustainable development, and the agenda is also to combat the environmental damage, poverty, disease through global cooperation on common interest. Now you can take this scenario as an example. We have an disease outbreak now, where all the global communities are coming together to address the issue. It's not about like the disease in one region. It's all about how international communities work together. The ultimate aim here is to have a future, right? The development should happen, at the same time the future is also to be seen. Planning is a widely accepted strategy for judicious use of resources. Country like India, where we don't have equal distribution of resources, it is important to have a proper planning structure so that we can achieve the holistic development of a nation. These are certain examples where we can understand the importance of resource planning. The first example is Rajasthan, where they lack in water resource, but at the same time they have high amount of solar and wind energy. So if the government knows like, so which region closer to Rajasthan have a water resource, they can take a proper step to bring in the resource, water resource from that area to Rajasthan, and this energy from here can be transmitted to other regions. So that is one case where they can have a balanced development. And the second example, we can see two different extreme cases. One, Madhya Pradesh, which is self-sufficient. They have all the resources which is important to satisfy their need. On the other side, Ladakh, which totally lacks the resources. And most important problem, the overuse or wastage of resources can be avoided if we have a proper planning structure, and the environmental pollution, the global ecological crisis, right? So why we saw in Agenda 21 also, which can be addressed if we have a proper resource planning. And the last one, over exploitation of resources. If the availability of resources identified in more than one place, then the government will concentrate on not over exploiting any particular region. So it is definitely important to have a proper resource planning. Here we can see the technique and skills which is adopted by India for the resource planning. There are three stages of resource planning. The first stage is always identifying. So we use surveying, mapping technique to identify where the resource is located, and it is all listed out. And second one, planning for exploitation. So where, how we are going to exploit the resource, whether we have a proper technology or we need to invest on the technology, whether we have skilled labors to work on the exploitation, or we need to develop these skill areas, any new institutional setup is needed, or whether with the present setup we can go ahead with the exploitation. All this is the second stage of resource planning. And third one is the most important. It is not the development of any particular region, it is the development of nation as a whole. The most important three stages of resource planning. The next topic is conservation of resources. Why should we conserve natural resources? We know the nature gives us abundant resources, but what we do, we overuse it, we exploit the resources. Now, to satisfy our need, we consume it. But what happens in the future? That becomes a problem, right? So to maintain the ecological balance, and at the same time to have healthy biodiversity and to preserve the resource for the future, it is really important to conserve the resources by adopting the concept of sustainable development. Here, I'm going to end the session with a quote of Mahatma Gandhi. Earth provides enough to satisfy every man's needs, but not every man's greed. These are some of the important questions based on the topics which we saw today. Thank you.